2 weeks ago, we came in, I think we did the priesthood, and we got in on the, you know, got in on the subject of what God is in Mormonism. And so, just to overview again, the Mormons have a priesthood. Actually, they have two priesthoods. The first one is the Aaronic priesthood, and, you know, these come out of the Bible. And the other one is the Melchizedek priesthood. I don't want to go over the whole thing again, but basically, if you're lone Mormon, you know, alone, a totem pole, basically, and you get for the men. If you're a lone Mormon, you're in the Aaronic priesthood, and then as you move up in your knowledge and in your faithfulness, which includes keeping certain commandments, doing certain things, and tithing and that kind of stuff, then you move up to what's called the Melchizedek priesthood, and then you're kind of an uppity up. And then they have other, you know, areas that you can get involved in. And last time we talked about the whole situation with both the Aaronic priesthood, which would be the Levitical priesthood, and the Melchizedek priesthood. And the Aaronic priesthood is null and void now, and the reason is because there is no temple. So it's all connected with the Jewish temple, and these guys aren't Jewish. Okay, so even the Aaronic priesthood for the Mormons doesn't work. To be in the Aaronic priesthood, you had to be a son of Aaron. And so Aaron was the brother of Moses. And, you know, one of the things that a lot of times these guys aren't getting, and sometimes Christians aren't getting it either, is that when you're talking about the people of Israel, you know that you're not Israel. Okay, you're not part of Israel. You're never going to be part of Israel. Unless you're Jewish, that's the way that this whole thing works. Or if you convert to Judaism, then you're considered part of Israel. Israel is a name for Jacob. Jacob had 12 sons, and they were literal guys. And so Reuben and Naphtali, and, you know, and you go on and on. Jacob and Joseph and Benjamin and all those guys. They are literal guys, and they have literal children. And so when you're talking about the 12 tribes of Israel, you're talking about the 12 sons of Jacob and all their offspring. That's who the 12 tribes of Israel are. And one of the 12 tribes was Judah. That's where Jesus came from the tribe of Judah. So did David. Another tribe was the tribe of Levi. And that's where Moses came from. And that's where his brother Aaron came from. And so Aaronic priesthood in the Bible are all the descendants of Aaron, the brother of Moses. And so they literally have to be descended from Aaron. And if you're not literally descended from Aaron, you can call yourself a Aaronic priesthood all day long, and you're just playing games. Because you have to literally be descended from Aaron. And so the high priest and all the priests came from that part of that tribe. That's how it works. Well, when Jesus comes along, what he does is he abolishes the Old Testament priesthood. So that's all done with because Jesus is the final sacrifice. And so can you still be descended from Aaron? Yes. But is there a priesthood? Even the Jews don't have a priesthood because there's no sacrifices to be done because there's no temple. And the Bible talks about the rebuilding of the temple, and that's some last days stuff. So they're going to go there again. But you're not part of the Aaronic priesthood unless you're from Aaron. And these guys are not. They're not from Aaron. And what they do is they play this whole game with God redid the whole priesthood and da-da-da-da-da, and, you know, anointed Joseph Smith and blah, 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 and stuff like that. And that is not the qualifications according to God. You have to be from Aaron's tribe. You have to be from Aaron's family. And so there is no Aaronic priesthood in the Mormon church. And, you know, again, what happens with these guys is they don't know all that stuff. They don't know what the Bible has to say about that, and so they play games with that. So in the book of Hebrews, in Hebrews chapter 7 specifically, it talks about that the fact that the Levitical priesthood was insufficient. That means the guys that came from the tribe of Levi, that priesthood was insufficient, and so God brought in another priest who was after another order, and that's the order of Melchizedek, and that Jesus is that priest after the order of Melchizedek, and that he has a better priesthood than the Levitical priesthood, in that he never dies. He's always the priest. And so in the Aaronic priesthood, what would happen is you were high priest in the Levitical priesthood until you died. And then your successor came in, and he became high priest until he died. And then the next one came in until he died. And they would give these sacrifices that they had to give every year because the sacrifices didn't actually cover sin. It was just a memorial looking forward to the sacrifice of Christ. Jesus comes in, and the Bible says he has an unchanging priesthood. It literally, it's the idea of a priesthood that never ends. So he's got an unchanging priesthood because once he made the sacrifice of his life, he never dies. So he's risen from the dead, and Jesus lives, and he lives forever. And so there's nobody to take his place because his place isn't empty. So in Aaron's priesthood, you were high priest until you died, and then the place was empty, then you had to get another one. In the Melchizedek priesthood of Jesus, Jesus takes the high priest role in the priesthood of Melchizedek, and he never dies, so nobody ever replaces him, so he's got an unchanging priesthood that lasts forever. And what that means is nobody else but Jesus can be there. And so they don't have that one either. And again, they don't understand that because they don't know what the Bible has to say about that. And that's all in Hebrews chapter 7. Are you guys priests? Yes, absolutely. In Revelation chapter 1:6, it talks about the fact that Jesus made us kings and priests. And in 1 Peter 2:9 and 10, same thing. Jesus made us kings and priests. And we are priests in the sense that we are not part of the Levitical priesthood or part of the Melchizedek priesthood. We are priests in the sense that we have this ministry. This is what priests did. They interceded to God for the people, and they represented God to the people. And that's what we do as believers. We intercede for others to the Lord, and we represent the Lord to them. And so the Bible talks about we're ambassadors for Christ. And so we're in a world that's not our own, and we're living in a place that is not our citizenship. Our citizenship is in heaven. And it's literally like we're in a foreign country representing our sovereign, our king, to the people of this country and asking them to change citizenship. Would you like to? It would be like, you know, being a diplomat from America going over to another country, and you have the right to tell people you can become a citizen of the United States right now if you'd like to. How'd you like to have that job? You know how many people would be coming to you? You know, it's like they'd be flocking you. And that's exactly what our ministry is. And so the Bible does talk about the fact that we're priests, but it never talks about it never says that we're priests according to the order of Melchizedek, and it never says that we're priests after Aaron or after the Levitical priesthood. That's not the kind of priesthood that we have. The other thing that we dealt with last week, and this is worth going over again, is a whole thing with God. The Mormons, again, believe that God is different than the God of the Bible. Now, the God of the Bible is timeless, and he alone, the Bible says, has immortality. That's the idea of he's the only one who's outside of time. When we become, when we die and go to heaven, we don't become immortal. What happens is we have everlasting life. When you're talking about immortality, as far as God's concerned, it's the idea of his eternality. He's eternal. And so he is the one who was, who is, and who is to come. He dwells in all places in time at the very same time. That's the point of that. In the Old Testament, when he identified himself to Moses, he identified himself as I am. I am that I am. You tell them I am has sent you. He's the eternal I am. He's the self-existent one. He's the only one who continues and never stops being what he is. And so that's what the Bible teaches about God. This is important for Christians to understand. Because when a Mormon comes and talks to you and asks you to explain who God is, one of the things that they'll come up with is, what was God doing before he created the universe? It's like, your God's eternal, and you say that at some point in time he created the universe. That's wrong. God did not create the universe in some point of time. Okay? And so in some point in time, he created the universe. And so what was he doing before he created anything? This is one of those questions that everybody asks, including Christians. And what the Bible teaches is that God lives outside of time. Okay? So he's outside of it. And so if you are outside of time, you are timeless. So you don't have a before, and you don't have an after. God's not sitting in some eternal present and, you know, waiting for things to happen. So God literally dwells outside of time. And the only thing, the only way that you can picture this, because you're never going to be able to picture this in your head, how can God have no time? The only way that you're going to be able to picture this whole thing is to think of creation in the way that it actually is. And the way that creation actually works is that it has four dimensions: height, width, breadth, and time. Time is a function of the creation. And so time acts in one way on the planet Earth, and it acts in another way for a satellite. And this is something that everybody deals with, and you don't know that you deal with it, but you do. You all have GPS on your phones, right? And so you can do Google Earth or do Google Maps, that kind of thing, and you can get directions, and it'll tell you where your car is at or where you're at within like 3 meters, that kind of thing. And so you're driving along. Did you know that the satellites that are giving you that information has to be adjusted for time, because the satellites are out of a gravitational field and they're moving at a certain speed, and time changes if you're on a planet versus in space. And so time is slower for somebody who's on a planet than for somebody who's just out in space. And time is slower for somebody who is moving than for somebody who, in relation to them, is standing still. And this is part of the equations that Einstein came up with. It's the whole relativity package. And so this stuff has been verified. And so when these satellites are out in space, all the satellites that do GPS, they have to fudge the satellites based on how far out in space they are and how quickly they're moving to get the GPS to work. Otherwise, everything would be off. And so we know that this is how it works. And so that lets you know that time is not something that's outside of the creation. It's part of it. You follow me? Okay. And so time is part of the creation. Well, if this is the creation and I'm God, by definition, I am outside of it. If I have created this, I can't be in it before I created it. So I am, by definition, as the creator, outside of this. So all of space, all of time, all of the dimensions, height, width, breadth, and time, all of it are contained here, and I'm out here. Okay? So time has no effect on me because I'm outside of time, right? And so with that, what you have when you're talking about God is timelessness. And so he's the only one who's eternal, the Bible says. And so God, being outside of time, again, does not have a before, because time before is connected with time. You follow that? And so when you're wondering what was God doing before he created everything, there is no before. Your question is wrong. You're asking the wrong, what was God doing before? You know what the answer to that is? No. There is no before. What will God be doing after? No. There is no after with God. Here's another thing. This is one of those things I like to point out in connection with the book of Revelation and heaven and all of that kind of stuff. Is heaven where God lives? Well, kinda. I mean, you always see him there, right? But he's everywhere. And again, what you've got is a situation where God's created everything. Did God create heaven? So by definition, where is God? He's got to be outside of it when he creates it. Now, after he's created everything, because he's also omnipresent, he can also be in here, right? He can be everywhere. He is everywhere. It's not he can be. It's he is everywhere at the same time. And so, is God in heaven? Yes. But God created heaven, and so he, by definition, is outside of heaven. And so when you see God in heaven, you know what he's doing? He's localizing himself in heaven. So all the angels can see him, and all the people who've died can see him. That's not his dwelling place in the sense of, you know, this is God's last bastion. It's where he hangs or something. You know, this is where he wasn't in heaven for eternity because heaven didn't exist for eternity. He made it. And so by definition, that has to have a beginning. And it's the same thing with the angels and that kind of stuff. And so God's in heaven, God's on earth, God's outside of the heavens and the earth, holds them in the span of his hand, the Bible says. And so you have all that stuff with God. And the Mormons don't have that concept. And so one of the things that they try to use when they're talking with Christians about God is the fact that God had to have a beginning somewhere. And so the guy had to come from somewhere, and so they have the answer. And the answer is from the planet Kolob. Literally, from the planet Kolob. And that's where the guy came from. He used to be a man on another planet. And there's been this eternal progression of gods. And so he had a god, and he had a god, and that god had a god, and that god had a god, and that god had a god and a planet and all that stuff eternally back. And so we're just dealing with one guy from the planet Kolob who has a name Elohim, and he became the god of this planet and has Jesus. And so that's the Mormon god. And all he is a big man up in heaven. I'll give you some of the teachings on the Mormon god. In the beginning, the head of the gods called a council of the gods, and they came together and concocted a plan to create the world and people it. That's the teachings of the prophet Joseph Smith. God himself was once as we are now and is an exalted man. And that is, again, the teachings of the prophet Joseph Smith. The Father has a body of flesh and bones as tangible as man's. The Son also, but the Holy Ghost has not a body of flesh and bones, but is a personage of spirit. That's Doctrine and Covenants, 130, verse 22. And so God, the Father, has a body of flesh and bones. What did Jesus say that God was? Yeah, God's spirit. And those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Remember after Jesus rose from the dead and all the disciples thought that he was a ghost? Remember what he said to them? Come up and touch me, for a ghost doesn't have flesh and bone as you see that I have. Okay? And so Jesus is identifying himself at that point as being flesh and bone. He wasn't a ghost. That's the point that he was making with these guys. And then he said, do you have a honeycomb, piece of fish? You know, have anything to eat? They gave him a honeycomb, piece of fish. And obviously he ate it at that point. And the point there is ghosts don't eat. Okay? And so you have that. And so there's a contradiction between what the Book of Mormon says about the Father, or Doctrine and Covenant says about the Father, and what the Bible says about the Father. Number four, gods exist, and we had better strive to be prepared to be one with them. That's Brigham Young. This is the mantra of Mormons concerning God. They say this over and over. As man is, God once was. As God is, man may become. And that's from the prophet Lorenzo Snow. Number six, each of these gods, including Jesus Christ and his Father, being in possession of not merely an organized spirit, but a glorious immortal body of flesh and bones. That's Parley Pratt. Here's another quote. And then the Lord said, let us go down. And they went down at the beginning, and they, that is, the gods, organized and formed the heavens and the earth. That's Book of Abraham 4:1. Remember that God, our Heavenly Father, was perhaps once a child and mortal like we ourselves, and rose step by step in the scale of progress and the school of advancements, has moved forward and overcome until he has arrived at the point where he now is. That's Orson Hyde. Mormon prophets have continuously taught the sublime truth that God, the Eternal Father, was once a mortal man who passed through a school of earth life similar to that through which we are now passing. He became God, an exalted being, through obedience to the same eternal gospel truths that we are given the opportunity today to obey. So again, they believe if they obey certain parts of the Mormon gospel, that they're going to become gods. Christ was the God, the Father of all things. Behold, I am Jesus Christ. I am the Father and the Son. And that's out of the Book of Mormon, Mosiah 7:27, Ether 3:14. When our father Adam came into the Garden of Eden, he came into it with a celestial body and brought Eve, one of his wives, with him. He helped to make and organize this world. He is Michael the Archangel, the Ancient of Days, about whom holy men have written and spoken. He is our Father and our God, and the only God with whom we have to do. And that's Brigham Young. And there he's teaching that Adam is God. Okay? It's the Adam-God theory. And you don't want to pick on Mormons about that because they've denounced that, basically. But that is something that Brigham Young taught. Historically, this doctrine of Adam God was hard for even faithful Mormons to believe. As a result, on June 8, 1873, Brigham Young stated, "How much unbelief exists in the minds of the Latter-day Saints in regard to one particular doctrine which I revealed to them and which God revealed to me, namely that Adam is our father and God. Well, says one, why was Adam called Adam? He was the first man on earth and its framer and maker. He, with the help of his brethren, brought it into existence. Then he said, I want my children who are in the spirit world to come and live here. I once dwelt upon an earth something like this in a mortal state. I was faithful. I received my crown and exaltation." And the whole thing goes on. And so, again, what they believe is that God is somebody who, over time, became exalted and became God. Okay? And so, obviously, that is not the God of the Bible. And so the Bible teaches that there are going to be people who come and they teach, share about a different Jesus, a different spirit, a different gospel, and obviously in this case, a different God. And that's not what God teaches, or that's not what the Bible teaches. So we did this last time. Let's go over it again. Isaiah 43. And this is just real. Let's go over it real quick. I'm not gonna spend a whole lot of time because this is supposed to be the introduction, but. But these verses are totally worth having and having them marked in your Bibles. Isaiah 43, 10, 11. 10 and 11. It's one of those passages that I always share with Mormons and have a great conversation with them. Verse 10, it says, "You are my witnesses, says the Lord, my servant, whom I have chosen, that you may know and believe me and understand that I am he. Before me there was no God formed." Before me there was no God formed. So there's never been a God before me, nor shall there be after me. There will never be another God after me. Okay? I am the Lord, and besides me, there is no Savior. Is that pretty straightforward? No gods before, no gods after. He alone is the Savior. I shared with you also Jeremiah 10:11, and then that's a great verse to tie into this, because in that passage it says that the gods that have not formed the heavens and the earth will be destroyed out from under this earth, or these heavens and on this earth. And one of the things that I asked them is, did you form the heavens and the earth? When I'm talking to a Mormon. And they'll go, well, no. And I'll go, Jeremiah 10:11. You're going to be destroyed. Because all the gods who have not formed the heavens and the earth are going to be destroyed out from under these heavens and this earth. And so obviously that is a judgment on the gods of the pagans, that they don't exist, they're not real. In fact, Paul said that the gods of the Gentiles are demons. And so, again, you have that whole thing. Isaiah 44, 6 and 8, go over there. This is good stuff. Thus says the Lord, the King of Israel, and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts. I am the first, and I am the last. Besides me, there is no God. Did I talk to you about pronouns there last time? How many guys are there? Thus says the Lord, the King of Israel, and his Redeemer. Is that another guy? You got the Lord, you got his Redeemer. right? The Lord of hosts. Okay? I am the first, and I am the last. Beside me, there is no God. So you got two guys there going, I'm the first and I'm the last. Besides me, there is no God. Isn't that weird? And what you have there is an indication of the plurality of God. In the sense that, you know, the Bible teaches that the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost are the one God. They are what God is. And so you have two guys mentioned there, and they both say, I'm the first and I'm the last. How many firsts can you have? Only one. How many lasts can you have? Only one. And again, that's that whole thing. That's pretty. And besides me, there is no God. Okay. Now, that is something that always used to freak out my Mormon boss. You know, I in fact, that verse flipped him out. I'm like, there's a plurality of God, the Father and the Son, in that passage, and they both are saying, I'm the first, I'm the last, besides me, there is no God. You could take them to Revelation after that, and Jesus talks about he's the Alpha and the Omega, the first, the beginning and the end. And the Father says, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. And that's all in Revelation chapter 1. And so, again, you have that whole principle there, and what Jesus said is, I and the Father are one. And so that flips them out, makes them all crazy and stuff, and it's pretty cool. So, in verse 8, it says, do not fear, nor be afraid. Have I not told you from that time and declared it? You are my witnesses. Is there a God besides me? Indeed, there is no other rock. I know not one. And again, you know, as we were talking about earlier in sharing, it's like they'll try to say, well, these passages are only dealing with the God of this world, but there are gods of the other worlds or gods of other universes and that kind of stuff. And so the Mormons apparently know about other gods, but the God of the Bible doesn't. He doesn't know anybody except for himself. And so that's it. Oh, by the way, that whole plurality thing, there's a passage in Zechariah chapter 10, or chapter 12, verse 10. You know the verse where it says, they'll look upon me, whom they have pierced? And then you have this whole thing with pronouns again. They'll look upon me, whom they have pierced. And it says that the Lord is talking. So it's Jehovah that's speaking there. Jehovah says, they'll look upon me, whom they have pierced, and mourn for him as for an only son. Why does he change the pronoun? And the reason is because what we're talking about is God. You know, there's a plurality there. And again, that's one of the reasons that we believe in the Trinity. Okay, Isaiah 45, verse 5. I'm using my wife's Bible here, and my eyes are going. Verse 5, it says, I am the Lord, and there is no other. There is no God besides me. I will gird you, though you have not known me. And so again, God says that there's no other gods besides him. And then in verse 21 and 22, it says, tell and bring forth your case. Yes, let them take counsel together. Who has declared this from ancient time? Who has told it from that time? Have not I the Lord? And there is no other God besides me. A just God and a Savior, there is none besides me. Look to me and be saved, all you ends of the earth, for I am God, and there is no other. And again, when you're sitting there and you're talking with the Mormons, the missionaries, and you share this stuff, they just start, you know, they flip out on the whole thing. It's like they first they want to just get rid of it. And one of the things that you never want to do when you're talking to anybody who's involved in a cult or an aberrant doctrine is go with their chain of scriptures. So, for example, when I'm talking to Jehovah's Witnesses, one of the things that I share with them, and we'll do Jehovah's Witnesses next, so one of the things that I share with them, they believe that Jesus is Michael the Archangel. And so I'll go, you know, at the beginning of the conversation, I'll go, you know what, if you can show me that Jesus is Michael the Archangel, I will convert and become a Jehovah's Witness. So all you got to do is show me that. I want a verse that says, Jesus is Michael the Archangel. And the problem that the JWs have is that what they do is they try to sling a whole bunch of verses together, and they don't have any connection to each other, and they go from one point to the next point to the next point, and through this chain of supposed logic, it's not really, it's leaps, basically, they come up with the idea that Jesus is Michael the Archangel. And it looks pretty convincing if you're not paying attention. And so basically what I do when I'm talking to anybody that's in this stuff, Bible teaches that they're in a fog. So the Bible says that the God of this age, the God of this world, has blinded the minds of those who don't believe. So they're going around blinded. They can't see straight. And so basically, I picture it as them being in a fog, and it's just all fuzzy to them, and it takes some persistence to clarify things for them. Because what they will do is they'll read your verse, ignore it, and move on to something else. And that's not what you want to do with somebody that you're sharing with. What you want to do is you want to pin them down to the verse and make them explain it. You know, help them to understand the whole thing so that it bugs them later on. And so I think I shared this last time in Isaiah 43:10-11 there. It says, you are my witnesses and my servants whom I have chosen, that you may know and believe me and understand that I am He, and before me there was no God formed, neither shall there be after me. And so they'll go, well, that's your interpretation. And I'll go, I didn't interpret it, I read it. You know, what's your interpretation? And they go, well, that's just for, da, da, da. You know, I go, that's not what it says. This is what it says, and I'll read it to them again. You're my witnesses, that you may know and believe me and understand that I am the Lord. Before me there was no God formed, neither shall there be after me. That's what it says. That's your interpretation. And they'll do that like 3 or 4 times until I make the point again that I didn't interpret it, I read it. And that's how you want to do this. And then what I do is I make them read it. I go, you read it now. And now they're reading it. And then they can't say that's your interpretation to themselves because they just read it. And now they're kind of stuck in the whole thing. And I'll go, fine. You know, it's like, you don't believe that. What's the interpretation? And so they'll try to come up with something. And I'll just go through and read it again. And I'll go, that's not what it says. This is what it says. And I keep doing that, keep doing that, keep doing that until they finally go, okay, I don't know what it means. And then I'm good. Okay, you don't know what it means. Honest answer. That's great. And that's something that's going to bug them when they go to bed at night. And that's what I want to do with them. And the same thing with the I was talking about the Jehovah's Witnesses. They'll take me to a verse that they're going to connect with a whole bunch of other verses, and I just pick apart that verse, and we don't move until I have them admit that it does not say in this verse that Jesus is Michael the Archangel. Okay? And so we go to the first verse, and it doesn't say that. I'll go, well, that doesn't say Jesus is Michael the Archangel. And they'll go, well, if you did, I go, no, I don't want to move on to another verse. Does this verse say that Jesus is Michael the Archangel? Well, no. Okay, let's do your next verse. And then we go to the next verse. And then I'll go, that doesn't say that Jesus is Michael the Archangel. There's no Jesus and Michael in the same verse. It doesn't say that. It says that Michael is the chief prince and Michael watches over the people of Israel. And it does say that, but that doesn't say Michael is Jesus. Does it? Now go like it. No, this verse right here. So your first verse didn't say it. Now your second verse doesn't say it either. Right? And then they finally admit it and go, okay, that one doesn't say it either. And then we go to the next one. And again, it doesn't say it there either. And then we go to the next one. And it doesn't say it there either. And I show them what it says. And at the end of that whole thing, what they end up with is, okay, well, I know it says it somewhere. And so I'll get somebody else to come with me next time, and they'll tell you where it says it. I'm like, okay, you do that. And then they go, get somebody and go through the same process again. And what you're doing is you're opening their eyes to the fact that what they've been doing, what's been happening there, is they've been strung along with this stuff. And it's what happens with Mormons, too. They've been strung along with all kinds of stuff. And so they, once you start challenging them and making them look at what the Bible actually has to say, it's just really wild what happens with them. And they start having some real issues, some real problems. It's the Word of God that's the sword of the Spirit. And so it's very cool. Yeah. No, their Bible, with the Mormons, it's the King James Version. It's exactly like your King James Version. Yeah. So when you're talking to Jehovah's Witnesses, that you'll have that issue. But again, we'll get to that when we get there. Okay, so then the next thing, so obviously there is only one God. God's the only one who's around, and He doesn't know about anybody else. And if God doesn't know about anybody else, then I don't think that anybody else knows about any other gods either. You know, it doesn't, it's not happening. The virgin birth, and this is where we left off last time. And again, this is one of those things that really tweaked me when I first learned about what they taught about this. Brigham Young taught this: when the time came that his firstborn, the Savior, should come into the world and take a tabernacle, talking about a body, the Father came himself and favored that spirit with a tabernacle instead of letting any other man do it. The birth of the Savior was as natural as are the births of our children. It was the result of natural action. He partook of flesh and blood, was begotten of his Father as we are of our fathers. Okay, so I don't have to do a whole thing on the birds and the bees with you. Okay, I had a father, I had a mother, and natural action meant that they did certain things, and here I came. Okay, that's where I came from. And this guy is saying that exactly the same thing happened. And so when you're talking about the virgin birth of Jesus, they'll say that they believe in the virgin birth, but it's literally God came down, took on a body, had sex with Mary. She was pregnant. 9 months later, she had the baby. That's how it worked. And you can try to redefine that all you want. That is not a virgin birth. Mary had sex with God. That's what that is. Mary had sex with God. Okay. And then when I was talking with my Mormon boss about this whole thing, it's like I always go to implications because that's the way that I think. You don't just leave it there. Mary had sex with God. Mary had sex with God, who is Elohim from another planet, who is the spirit father of every spirit that comes to this planet. You get that? So he's up in this heaven where he's making babies, spirit babies, and every time that somebody's born, one of those spirit babies comes to inhabit that body. It's literally what Mormonism teaches. And so literally, Elohim is the father of all of us. And when you are sitting there listening to a Mormon and they say, our heavenly father, that's what they mean. They're not talking about our heavenly father like the Bible teaches. We're adopted into the family of God and we get to be called the children of God because we've received Jesus. That's not what they're talking about. They're literally talking about they used to be a spirit baby up in heaven, and now they inhabit this body right now, and he's our heavenly father in that sense. So if he's my heavenly father, and if he's your heavenly father, all the Mormons' heavenly fathers, then what was he to Mary? Literally, her heavenly father. So he's her father. So Dad came down. That's exactly what's going on here. Dad came down and did it with his daughter. That's the Mormon virgin birth. Okay? That's messed up. Right? Here's the other thing. Was Mary married? Yeah. No, yes. And the answer is yes to all of that. She hadn't consummated the marriage, but she was engaged to Joseph. The Bible calls it betrothed. And a betrothal in those days was a marriage contract. You were married when you got betrothed, and you just hadn't consummated the wedding. So you got betrothed about a year later. You had the actual wedding day where you went into you did the whole honeymoon thing. And so to get out of a betrothal, you had to get a divorce. And so if Mary has sex with anyone else during the time of her betrothal, any other man during the time of her betrothal, she is not committing just fornication. She's committing adultery. Okay? And so now you have a situation where Mary is betrothed to Joseph, and God, Elohim, comes down and does it with her. Yeah, it's incest and adultery all at the same time. That's tweaked. That's messed up. And actually, that just comes straight from paganism. You know anything about the Greek gods? You know where Hercules came from? Yeah. Zeus comes down, has sex with a woman. She has a baby. He's a demigod. That's Hercules. And it's exactly what the pagans taught. It's exactly the same thing. And so that's what the Book of Mormon teaches, or actually that's what Mormon doctrine teaches about the virgin birth, okay? And so, again, they say that they believe in the virgin birth, but they define it out of existence. And that's not the Jesus of the Bible. It's a different story. So the Jesus of the Bible has a specific history. And he is the Word who became flesh, and he became flesh when God made him a body and placed it within Mary, according to Hebrews chapter 10. And so that's the definition of who Jesus is, and they've redefined it. And that, again, is the whole thing with Mormonism and actually any cult, any group. They go through and semantic. Most of the stuff is semantics. They just redefine everything. And so you can sit there and you can talk to them like I was talking about before during sharing, and they'll say, I believe in God. I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. I believe, but it's like this. So when you ask a Mormon if they believe that Jesus is the Son of God, then what they're thinking is, God comes down, has the whole thing with Mary, she gets pregnant, baby later on, right? By the way, did God marry her? So now it's incest, fornication, and adultery. Okay? So that's that's a situation with that. And so it's another deal with a redefinition. Jesus himself. Okay, now because of that whole, and we already did the, earlier on, I'm not going to give you all the references to the whole spirit baby thing. But again, you have this situation where Elohim, by the way, that's a biblical name for God. It's one of the Hebrew names for God. Elohim comes from this planet Kolob, or the star Kolob, depending on which Mormon dictionary you're looking at. And he becomes the God of this planet, and he brings his spirit wives, begins having spiritual sex with them and making babies. And so that's where we all came from, according to Mormonism. So your spirit came from the coupling of Elohim and one of his wives, right? Okay. And so because of that, we're all brothers and sisters. And so when a Mormon calls somebody a brother or sister, that's what they're thinking, okay? If we're all brothers and sisters, what about Jesus? Is Jesus our brother? Does the Bible say that? It does. The Bible talks about Jesus being our brother. Okay, who's my mother? Who's my brother? That whole thing. Anybody who does the will of God. So Jesus identifies us as brothers with him. And obviously, there's the brethren and the sisterhood. And so you have that whole thing. But in Mormonism, literally, we're brothers with Jesus. Literally. Okay? So he's my big brother up in heaven, right? And not only us, all the demons came from that whole thing. So basically what you had up in heaven was you had this situation where at the Council of the Gods, according to Mormonism, when they're putting all this stuff together as far as how the world's going to go, Lucifer came up with a plan on how salvation was going to go, and then Jesus came up with a plan on how salvation was going to go. Lucifer's plan got voted down. Jesus's plan got accepted. Lucifer and Jesus, you know what they are? They're brothers. So literally, in Mormonism, the devil is the brother of Jesus in Mormonism. Okay, the reason that he became the devil is because when his plan got shot down, he got all mad and formed a rebellion against Elohim. And in that rebellion, other brothers and sisters turned away from Elohim, and they become the demons. They become the fallen angels. Okay, and then there were all the good guys who fought for Elohim in that rebellion, and they became white people. No joke. They became white people. And then you had all the people who couldn't make up their minds. And those are the people, according to Mormon doctrine, those are the people who are born with dark skin. And it's a curse that's been put on them because of the rebellion in heaven and the fact that they did not choose for God. And so that was a huge deal all the way up until the 1970s. In fact, during the time that I was working for my Mormon boss, that's when one of the Mormon prophets came out and said, okay, we don't go for that anymore. You know, they changed that whole story. Now, I don't even know what they did with it, but they said, you know, basically what the previous Mormon prophets had taught was that no dark-skinned person would be part of the Mormon church in the sense of being in the priesthood until every white person became Mormon. That's what they had taught up until that point. And then they came back and they annulled that whole thing. And part of the reason for that was because they were making inroads in South America. And so obviously, you know, people in South America have darker skin than people in the Americas and that whole thing. And so they have to tweak things. God changed his mind, is basically what happened there. Okay. And so that's the story of where we all came from. And so Lucifer in Mormonism is the brother of Jesus. Is that the Jesus of the Bible? No. And so when they're talking about Jesus, that's what they're talking about. So in Mormonism, Jesus is the spirit brother of Satan. He's the product of Elohim and Mary and an incestuous relationship and an adulterous relationship. He's the product of that whole thing. Jesus literally got married in Mormonism to both Marys and Martha. So you know the women disciples? So the Mormons believe that he had multiple wives, that he had children. Both Marys and Martha were married to Jesus. Is that the Jesus of the Bible? No, it's not. Yeah. It's, you know what happens in Mormonism, most of this stuff is out of the book of, out of Doctrine and Covenants. And so they have a number of scriptures. And so you have the Book of Mormon, you have the Pearl of Great Price, you have Doctrine and Covenants, and you have, I'm blanking on the fourth one. The Book of Abraham. And so that's all in Doctrine and Covenants. And what Doctrine and Covenants are the teaching of the Mormon prophets. What they teach in Mormonism is that the president of the Mormon church is the prophet. So the first president was Joseph Smith, and he came up with most of this stuff. Okay? And then Brigham Young was the second one, and he came up with the whole Adam God thing, and he codified polygamy and all of that kind of stuff. And over the years, they keep having new prophets who come along, and they teach all these things. And so it's literally where they get it from. They say that God has given them a revelation, and that revelation to a Mormon becomes scripture. So when a Mormon prophet, including the one who's a prophet down in Salt Lake City right now, when a Mormon prophet speaks prophetically, it's written down, and it becomes scripture to the Mormons. Okay? And that's why, you know, a lot of times one prophet will contradict another prophet, and you're going to have these changes and that kind of thing. So literally, they made it up. Literally. So it doesn't come from the Bible. Doesn't come from anywhere like that. Is that good? Okay. Yeah. Like, what's that? You know, I don't know that we know the names of any of Elohim's wives. So, never. Yeah. No, it's not very. Yeah. Yeah, half-brother. Another thing that you have with Mormonism is the Jesus of Mormonism, his blood doesn't cover sin. His blood doesn't cover sin. What Jesus' blood covers is your resurrection. And so we teach salvation by grace, right? And that's because of Ephesians 10 and 11. And it says, you've been saved by grace through faith, and that's not of yourselves. It's the gift of God. Not of works, lest anyone should boast. And then it says, we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, that God foreordained that we should walk in them. And, you know, that whole thing. And so we believe that salvation is by grace. Mormons will tell you, you ask them, do you believe in salvation by grace? And they'll say, yes, I believe in salvation by grace plus works. They'll always add in plus works. And you go, well, which part of salvation is by grace? And they'll go, well, just, you know, salvation is by grace, but plus works. And what Mormons teach is that salvation in the Bible equals resurrection. So when you say, I'm saved by grace, when you're saying that, you're saying that my sin has been forgiven, it's been covered by the blood of Jesus, that I am no longer liable to God for judgment because the wrath of God was poured out on Christ instead of poured out on me. And so all the things I deserve, Jesus took on himself so that I can get what Jesus deserves. That's what salvation means to a believer. And so I've been forgiven for my sin. To a Mormon, when you say salvation by grace, all they believe that Jesus' blood covered was your resurrection. So the only thing that's going to happen to you because Jesus died for you is you're going to get raised from the dead. That's it. And then everything else is based on how good you are. So that's why they go salvation plus works. Yeah. They believe that angels and people are the same thing. And so in the story of the founding of the Mormon Church, there's a guy named Moroni who used to be a Jewish man who lived in America fighting in a battle against the bad guys. He dies in that battle and he goes to heaven and becomes an angel again. Basically, he's got a spirit body up in heaven, and he reveals himself to Joseph Smith as the angel Moroni. And so you start out as spirit children, which to Mormons are angels, and then you come down and spend your life in this body, and then when you die, you go back up and you become an angel again. And by the way, that's something that a lot of people have a misconception about. We are not angels when we go to heaven. When we go to heaven, we're higher than the angels. In fact, we judge angels. And so angels are servants, and they're spirits that are there to serve us. We are not angels. We're made in the image of God, not the image of angels. And so they got a whole messed up thing about that, too. Yeah, back in the mic. Yeah. Yeah. Right. And you know what, you guys, most of this stuff you have to dig and pry. You know, because they're not walking up to your door going, "Hi, I'm a Mormon. By the way, you know, later on I'm going to become a god. I just want you to know that, and I'm going to have my own planet. And by the way, this is where Jesus came from. You know, God did the whole thing with Mary." And they're not going to tell you that. And so what you have to do is you have to pin them down. You go, when I'm talking with Mormon missionaries, they don't want to talk about this stuff. And what I do with them is I go, "I know that this is what the church teaches. So let's talk about it. So, do you believe that you're going to become a god?" So him and ha, and I go, "Okay, fine. If you keep all the commandments and you do all the teachings of the Mormon gospel, are you going to become a god? Have your own planet?" And then they'll say, "Yes, I do believe that if I do all that stuff." And then you can go in and talk about those issues. Yeah, then. That is really cool, and that's really the deal with the Bible. A lot of the archaeological finds that you have over in Israel and over in these other countries, literally, guys picked up the Bible and looked at what the geography was and walked to the place, and started digging, and you can't do that with the Book of Mormon, and so that's cool. Okay, so salvation equals resurrection. Okay, and then in the Mormon gospel, if you are going to be forgiven for your sin. In the Mormon gospel, it's not like what the Bible teaches, that what we're supposed to do is we give our lives to Christ, and it's that whole thing where Jesus' blood covers us. Jesus' blood does not cover them for forgiveness of sin. It does not cover them. What covers them is obedience to the Mormon gospel, and they have to obey it perfectly. If they don't obey it perfectly, they are not forgiven. And Those are things that you can share with them. It gets a little bit more esoteric with that because you have to show them verses and things like that. But that's basically where they're at. They're on a big fat works trip, and they're not even keeping their own commandments. And so when you share that stuff with them, and go, have you repented of all your sin? Are you still sinning in an area? What's going to happen to you? Will you be forgiven for that? They're not. Yeah. Well, yeah, you know, again, none of that's in the Bible. The Bible's really clear on this. And so 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse, you know, at the end of the chapter, it's this whole section on the fact that Jesus takes our place, and that he literally, the reason we're going to heaven is because of what Jesus has done, and the wrath of God's poured out on him. And so, yeah, you can go to any number of scriptures in the Bible, but what you have to do is you have to get them to the place where they're starting to consider what the Bible has to say and seeing the difference there. And, you know, it's a process of their eyes opening and that kind of stuff. But, you know, they have no hope. You know, it's like when you're talking about the Mormon gospel, they have no hope of they have to be perfect. And it's obviously not going to happen. Here's the last thing that I wanted to deal with, and we're out of time. But real quick, turn over to 2 Corinthians chapter 12. 2 Corinthians chapter 12. And this is one of those that people run into all the time. And they get all confused by it. Chapter 12, verse 1. It says, "It is doubtless not profitable for me to boast. I will come to visions and revelations of the Lord." In the next verse, he says there, "I know a man," and Paul's talking about himself, "I know a man in Christ who 14 years ago, whether in the body I do not know, or whether out of the body I do not know, God knows, such a one was caught up to the third heaven. And I know such a man, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know, God knows, how he was caught up into paradise and heard inexpressible words, which it is not lawful for a man to utter. Of such a one I will boast, yet of myself I will not boast except in my infirmities." Okay? And so Paul talks about the fact that he's caught up to the third heaven. And so from that, Joseph Smith came up with three heavens. And so you have what's called the celestial heaven, that's the highest one. And then you have the terrestrial heaven, that's the one down below that. And then you have a telestial heaven. So telestial, terrestrial, and celestial heaven. All the good Mormons go to the celestial heaven. If you're a good Mormon, that's where you're going to end up. If you are a Gentile, which is all of you, and you're a decent Gentile, then you're going to end up in the terrestrial heaven. Okay? I, according to all the Mormons that I knew, was going to end up in the celestial heaven. Just want you to know. Because I asked him, when I die, what's going to happen to me? And they go, "You know what? You know, it's like you're really following your religion, and you're a great guy, and I think you're going to the celestial heaven, Steve." You know, it's kind of like pat on the back to me and stuff. And so they were wrong, by the way. That's not what Mormonism teaches. Mormonism teaches I'm going to the terrestrial heaven, and now that I'm a pastor, I'm going to hell. Okay, so in any case, the highest you can attain is a terrestrial heaven. And then if you're a bad guy, you go to the celestial heaven, okay? And you can work your way out of those places. And baptism, one of the reasons that they baptize for the dead is to get dead. They're making them Mormons is what they're doing. And they're getting them out of the terrestrial heaven, moving them up to the celestial heaven. That's what's happening in that whole thing. And so they have this whole thing with three heavens. Okay, so are there three heavens? And according to this passage, Paul was caught up to the third one, so there must be three, right? And so Mormonism has supplied that whole story. Are there three heavens in the Bible? Are there? What's called heaven in the Bible? Is the atmosphere called heaven? Yeah, Genesis chapter 1 and verse 20 talks about the firmament, the heavens, and that the birds fly in it. Is that heaven? Okay, yeah. And is space called heaven in the Bible? And again, in Genesis chapter 1, it talks about God set the stars and the sun and the moon in the heavens. Okay? So there's a heavens, the atmosphere. There's a heavens of space. Right? Final frontier. Right? And then there's another heaven. And which one would that be? Yeah, the heaven where God's throne is at. And so how many is that? That's three. So you got atmosphere, you got space, and you got the third heaven, which identifies here as paradise. It's heaven where God's throne is. And so they make up this whole story about three heavens and all that stuff and come up with all this stuff, and the Bible is really clear on this. All Paul's talking about is he went to heaven, what we would call heaven. He's just defining it. It's not heaven the atmosphere. It's not heaven space. It's heaven where God's throne is at. And that's all that's talking about. And so, again, they have another whole story about that. And so when they are talking about when they're talking about heaven, when you're talking to a Mormon about heaven, the answer a Mormon, you know, you go, well, what do you think about heaven? What a Mormon would say back to you is, which one? Okay? And they would be talking about these three. Okay? One of the things also that you need to know is, well, this is another one of those things that you can use with them, is the Mormons believe everybody's going to heaven. Everybody's going, except for apostates and pastors and murderers and demons. Okay? So everybody's going to heaven except that group, right? And so you guys are all in, I'm out. I need a new job. And actually, one of the things that, again, one of the reasons that I was asking a Mormon what they thought about what would happen when I died is because of that whole doctrine. And so with my Mormon friends, I said, so, you know, let me just ask you, what's going to happen when I die? And they go, well, you're going to go to heaven. I go, which one? And again, what they said was, you're a great guy. You follow your religion. You're for real about it. So you're going to the celestial heaven, Steve. It's like, oh, great. That's awesome. You know what happens if you die and I'm right? And that's where you go with it. And, you know, it's not a dig. And what I'll tell them is, you're saying that I'm going to the celestial heaven. Well, yeah, you are, but you're not going to be a god because you don't follow Mormonism. I don't want to be a god. Okay, so we're all good at that point. And what I tell them is, so if you're right and I'm wrong, I'm going to the celestial heaven. And again, they had it wrong, but you know what I mean. I'm going to the celestial heaven. And if I'm right and you're wrong, you're going to be separated from God forever. There's going to be weeping and gnashing of teeth. You're going to be destroyed from the presence of God. And you're going to be screaming forever. And that's your destiny. You will see God. You're going to get to heaven. You will see him. There's going to be a judgment at the great white throne. And he's going to say, depart from me, you worker of iniquity. I never knew you. And then you're going to Gehenna, to the lake of fire. And that's where you're going to dwell for the rest of eternity. So if I'm right and you're wrong, you're in big trouble. If you're right and I'm wrong, no problem. Right? And again, you know, it's one of those things that you use when you're talking to them to get them to think and that kind of thing. And again, I don't go after Mormons and just get digs on them and, you know, try to one-up them and stuff like that, because this is serious stuff. It's serious stuff. And Jesus loves these people and he wants them to know him. And so, again, whenever you're talking about dealing with the cults, with any group like this, you have to know certain, obviously, you can tell from what we've talked about tonight, you have to know some stuff about what they believe. And then you can speak intelligently to them. And so again, there are a number of books that you can get on this stuff. And actually, you know, like Ben was saying, I haven't looked it up, but there's probably all kinds of stuff on YouTube and different websites. You have to be careful with that, you know, how the internet is, okay? And so you want to go to reputable places, but apologetics.org is a good one. Apologetics.org, they go through and they give you quotes and references, and they're footnoted to let you know what's going on. But one of my favorite books that every Christian should have in their library is The Kingdom of the Cults by Walter Martin. It's been updated and edited and that kind of stuff, and it just gives you, it's a good book because it goes over all these different cultic groups and tells you where they came from, what they believe, who their founders were, all that stuff, and it's just good stuff. So if you want to witness to people, you gotta be prepared for it. So, is that good? Okay, end of Mormonism. Right there, let's pray. And Father, again, we thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you for the work that you've done in our lives. And Lord, thank you that our salvation rests in you. It doesn't rest in us, doesn't rest in what we can do for you. We're not here performing for you. Lord, we do want to please you, and it's because we love you. But Father, we have a salvation that's given to us as a free gift, and it's something that we don't deserve, and it's something that's given by you. You said in your word that salvation is by grace, which is not deserved. It's not something that you work for. Otherwise, grace is no longer grace, and works are no longer works. Work is no longer work, you said in Romans chapter 11. So, Father, we just pray that you'd just give us opportunity to share with people and just to love them into the kingdom and just to really be a good witness to these people who are working so hard and don't know you yet. Just pray that you'd use us, Lord. We ask that you do this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. God bless you.